Hey everyone, welcome to the latest episode of the Sam Taylor podcast. My name is Janine and I'm the guest producer for this episode. I'm a recent graduate from the Master of Information program at Dalhousie with an undergraduate degree in business and psychology from the University of Waterloo. I spent the majority of my 20s living and traveling abroad, and I found myself back at school in the hopes of ending up in a managerial position. Today on the podcast, Sam is speaking with Dr. Philippe Mongeon, an assistant professor at the School of Information Management at Dalhousie University. Philippe has a BAA from UQAM, along with an MSI and PhD from the University of Montreal. Philippe runs a Quantitative Science Studies Lab, in which he collaborates with multiple graduate students, postdocs, and faculty members on various projects, mostly using bibliometrics. He joined Sam to discuss how he came to Dalhousie, highlights from his research, the importance of community, and the problems with academic publishing. You may be interested in this conversation if you would like to learn more about bibliometrics and how you can help contribute to a more just publishing system. Having worked with both Sam and Philippe, it was great to get to listen in on their conversation. Enjoy.
Thanks for joining the podcast.
Thanks for having me, Sam.
Yeah, no, you actually, yeah, thanks for telling me to just click the fucking record button. So we're here.
Finally, Jesus.
Yeah. All right. I mean, I was going to start off with a little fun icebreaker. I don't know how provocative it is now after that starting, but Philippe, what's your favorite kind of beer?
Oh, that is provocative. It depends, Sam. It depends a lot. But lately, I've been pushing back again that I don't like hype in general. It's all those IPAs stuff. And like, you know, so I'm kind of to make a point to say, hey, why don't we just drink a good old Budweiser, guys? So I order pitchers of Budweisers when you go out just to say, hey, it's beer. It's cheaper. It's good. And so like, it's kind of a philosophical, I don't know, it's not a philosophical pleasure, but, you know, it's kind of like countercurrent, sort of like, yeah, I'm trying to make a point. But like, I do like IPAs and all these other kinds of beers, but that's it. I just said it on your podcast.
Jeez. No, now it's recorded. It's in the interwebs. Okay, so I was wondering though, Budweiser, is there nothing cheaper at the campus bar?
Oh, than yeah,
Budweiser?
PBR, Labatt 50, Wildcat for all I care. Yeah, Wildcat here. Maybe it's a Quebec thing.
And it's or Alberta, Black Label. What's like that?
Black Label. I wouldn't go that, like the classics, the things that. You know, you used to drink at the bar in the 90s. Nobody ever drank Black Label at the bar. I'm not sure.
There's but a pub in Calgary that I went for wings one time and it was on tap. And I was like, huh. Okay.
I mean, it's beer if it's cheaper. If the price matches, sometimes it helps.
I like that.
Yeah.
So it's interesting because I still haven't... I don't want to say reading is like this, but like, I still haven't gotten through Bordeaux's social distinction, but I will say that I'm like, huh. And speaking with you and getting to know you last couple of years and, you know, talking about, you know, stumbling into the beer preference, it's been great. So let's rewind before we go forward. Philippe Mongeon, what brought you to Dal and how did we meet? Because first you came to Dal and then we met.
Thank you, Sam, for changing subject, I guess. Anyway,
oh,
no, I'm just kidding. No, beer is fine. But how did we go from beer to like, how did you came to Dal?
Oh, we're going to go backwards to go forward because the beer does come into it a lot.
Does it?
I feel like it does. Ooh. I feel like that's a common theme throughout all of this.
I came for the beer. Oh, shit. No, I didn't come for the beer. But it's fine. I'll answer your question.
Okay.
Well, I came to Dal by like anybody comes to Dal because they get a job at Dal. Or, you know, nobody comes here because they want to, really. I'm just kidding. It's a joke.
Our entire audience of people that registered at Dal.
I'm in a funny mood.
I love it.
I applied to Dal in 2018 when I was doing my last year of my PhD, and they did not want me then. And I was like, and I already like had ideas of like creating an institution that would be called the Mists, like the, you know, the Maritime Mists. And then as like, I would come to you and create the Mists, and it would be great. And then they didn't want me, and I kind of like moved on, and then applied for another job in other places, UBC, and that was pretty much it, really. And then the second chance came, and then I nailed it.
Yes.
And here I was in the middle of the pandemic in 2020. So for the first year, I was in Montreal, actually, as I got hired in 2020. So I stayed in Montreal, which was my own base at the time. Also Denmark, but whatever.
I was going to say, because like, what was your consolation prize for not getting Dal? Where did you go?
The first time? Oh, yeah. Well, I went to August, Denmark.
Yeah, darn.
Yeah, that's pretty darn. Good, actually. Yeah. I recommend it. Denmark, Aarhus. Yeah, you should go. Fantastic condition. I mean, it's a different world, right? Academic conditions here. You're a postdoc. Like, craft dinner and, you know, you get a shark grant. You still can't eat properly. But in Denmark, they actually pay you very decently. And as an international, you don't pay the same taxes as everybody else. So as a postdoc, I was, you know, I had a salary that probably was higher than a lot of profs. Maybe not here at faculty management, but, you know, in the six figures, I would say, or close as a postdoc, which is really a different. And even like PhD students, they're not students. They're actually employees. They get paid to do their PhDs. They have their own offices. Wait a second. Come to Dal.
No. We're all about truth here. No, wait a minute. You were paid to work on your research for 2 years in Denmark at a very favorable salary. So it kind of sounds like it was great.
It was great, but it was not as great. And it's weird because it should, I guess it's contextual, but like the PhD, Sam, best years of my life. I had so much time, traveled the world, met a lot of people, wrote a lot of paper, developed as a researcher. I mean, yeah, if you're a grad and undergrad students listening to this, do a PhD with me. it'll be fun. Or with Sam. I don't know. But all this thing, like, yeah, it was all fun. And coming here at Dallas, also a lot of fun. It was tough in the first year because it was all virtual. Sorry. But such a good job and such amazing people. And it's, you know, it's a different dynamic when you're in a rough position, but I just enjoy it just as much as I enjoyed all the years that led me here. And then I met you. On Teams, because Colin, who was supposed to be here with us today, just said, hey, you two should meet. I don't know why. I still don't know why, but man.
So you haven't figured it out.
That's where my whole embrace the chaos philosophy comes from. It's like, you know, there's Sam, and then we chat, and it's kind of like, embrace it. No, and Colin was right. We get along. And very different. We're very different.
What?
Like, you're from across the hall. It's a very different. Yeah. Culture.
I am across the hall in the business school.
Yes.
That is Sam. She does all that. You give the best intros, by the way.
I know. And that's how we met. That's how we met, because Colin introduced us. But, you know, we were going to meet anyway because we are colleagues in the same department. So, you know, let's give Colin some credit. But
Absolutely. And then, yeah, we chit-chatted. I asked you to write a blog post. And I later found out that Philippe is a world-class scholar and a leader in his field that writes a lot of very high-level research. So that was, but the cool thing about being colleagues is respect, right? And I think that's likely what Colin saw, is that we both care about our disciplines. We both, you know, give a shit about what we do and are have high standards for ourselves. We just don't always have a ton of like natural overlap.
That's what he told you.
No, that's not what he told me. No, just you. Man. We met virtually on Teams, talked about our blog post for a while, and little did I know that that would likely that would evolve to paper. Between the three of us. So we'll see where that goes and how that goes, and as well as your tomatoes on Friday. So do you want to tell people what tomatoes are?
Oh. Are they a fruit or a vegetable? Has that been settled?
Gosh. We're going to go with fruit.
Okay. So, I mean, probably some of your listeners will have heard of the Pomodoro technique, where it's just like a way of structuring time where you focus on something for a short period of time, take a break, focus again, take a longer break. So it's just a way of pacing so that you don't deplete your mental capacity and focus. And then alongside this is, you know, you could just have the time part, and that would, you know, I work for 25 minutes and then I take a break. So I do Pomodoros. and that's a way to structure your time. But you can add a couple of layers to that, and like setting goals that you can accomplish in 25 minutes. So it helps like divide complex tasks into simpler pieces. And that's part of the way, that part of the, I guess, not solution, but it's an approach in increasing like productivity, I guess, or just, you know, it just simplifies the problem because you just made the mental effort of like chopping it into like smaller chunks that you can accomplish. And then you get the little boost of like, because you just accomplished something and then you do it again in 25 minutes. So just by doing these simple exercises, I guess, you can get a lot more done in a day. And it's not because I'm obsessed with productivity and squeezing more of your lemon, more out of your lemon, but it's because I'm obsessed with time. And I think time is a resource that we don't have enough of. So why would you take 3 days to do something that you can do in one? Without, of course. So I think it's just, you know, that's why I like to do tomatoes. You get stuff done.
Yes.
Part two, Tomato Fridays. It's not just me in my office in the dark, like setting a timer and doing tomatoes. It's a collective thing where we add the layer of social pressure. Because if you're by yourself and you set yourself a tomato.
No, it's community. Not social pressure. Community.
Okay, community. Of course. So we chat and we talk about our goals that we set for the next tomato. We put them on the board and then like say, okay. And then when the timer stops, say, hey, Sam, did you finish your tomato? And Sam says, yes, I did. And we scratch it and we have a round of applause. And then so during the break, we relax a little bit and celebrate our success for the past 25 minutes. And then we set our next goals and we repeat. And then we go for beers at the end of the day. And it's just an entire day of like, it's both social. I like to say that it's both the most social and the most productive time of the week. And it, usually those things don't correlate, but somehow the tomatoes, it's like magic, right? It's the best of both worlds combined. We are getting shit done, feeling good about ourselves, heading into the weekend without a full plate because and you get to socialize with your friends and have beer. It's kind of an amazing thing. I've been doing this for several years of just, I implemented this here at Dal because I wanted to, and it's a success. And a lot of people attend these things, and that's what Tomato Fridays are. And you should try it.
Totally. Yeah, if you're listening to this and you want to join Tomato Fridays, it's not where just the profs get together. It's profs, grad students, undergrads are welcome. So
yes,
yeah, everyone. Like it's a good accountability measure, but really it's worked. Work disguises fun, really, or fun.
Work is fun, Sam. Why does it have to be? Yeah, exactly.
It can be, but I will say, so as a numbers gal, who's in her doctorate right now, it's difficult to sit down with a blank screen, or it's difficult to sit down and start writing and start kind of developing. You know, there's a place where you know you want to go and a place that you are. And it's really nice to have, you know, that sense of community or that social pressure to break down your project into lots of little things and then be able to say, and by the way, you're too generous because I'm always like, I got a third of my tomato done, right? Because I'm still learning. I'm still figuring out what is a task that I can actually accomplish in 25 minutes. And people cheer just as loud for the third of a tomato as they do for somebody that fills in all their tomatoes all the time.
That's true. That is true. It's all about support. That's like shame.
No, absolute support. Hey, what is that beef jerky?
No, it's a Coke bottle, a gummy.
A gummy. Wow.
Budweiser and gummy. That's my doom.
Okay, good. I'm making a list. It's on the internet. Okay, cool. So we got our tomatoes. We got our beer. What else?
It's all food related. Amazing.
I know. I'm struggling to see where the through line is with food. I don't know. We'll get there. You said embrace the chaos, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So embrace the chaos. So you are across the hall. You are not an accountant. But yet I tease you and say our disciplines are really similar, that you're just kind of like an accountant for books. So how about you tell me a bit about,
fine.
About your discipline, Philippe, and what's kind of your field?
I hate to admit it, but you're kind of right, Sam. I am an accountant for books. It's called Bibliometrics, and it has other names, folks. Bibliometrics, biblio, books, metrics, measure. So we apply quantitative methods to sort of count things that are in documents or documents, right? So my data is documents and my methods are quantitative, and I try to make those documents speak, and mostly not the books themselves, but like the metadata, like about the books and about their content and the authors. But actually, in my field, we don't use books. We use documents that are scientific documents, so databases of scholarly research mostly. Why? Because rich metadata, historically, it's used for research evaluation. There's lots of reasons why, but like availability of the data is one. It's not as easy to do with books. So essentially, there's like science. Scientists write papers. Papers get published. Papers go into these databases where you can find them. But there are some databases that have extra features where you can actually identify links between papers called citations. So I cite a paper, like my paper is published, it goes into a database, and then there's a citation index that says my paper is citing that paper. And then you can create what we call a web of science. And you might have heard of the web of science, the database. Uh-huh. So that's where the name comes from. Like Eugene Garfield in the 60s, he created this thing. And in the 60s, by the way, there was no web of science as we understand it today. It was like an encyclopedia collection. You would go to the library, and then you'd have like, you know, a full wall of volumes, and then you would open and you find, okay, you find my paper, and it would have like, it cites B1, C62, and then these are indexes for other papers. So you would go to the B volume, and then you'd get, oh, that's the paper that was cited in that paper. And then you would trace knowledge, you know, because scientists build on the shoulder of giants, the expression, right? So you cite your predecessor, so you can know that this knowledge led to this knowledge. It's not working exactly like that. And that's because you folks cite like citation behavior.
Accountants or everybody else.
People write paper. Like, they don't necessarily follow this, like, you know, anyway, it doesn't matter. But like in principle, this link between papers is an indication that they are related in some way. And when you have millions of papers being published all the time, or not all the time, but every year, They feed into this sort of global stock of knowledge, just like the scientific brain. And then you can understand like what parts of the brain are super active, which ones are depleting, which ones are increasing, who's citing who, what are the dynamics, where does the money go? Mm. It's like a huge field. And with this one database, we publish hundreds and thousands of papers every year, just trying to understand how this global scientific system works through the lens of research publications and other kinds of outputs that are documents. So that's what I do, Sam. I account for citations. I count citations in and out, and inflows and outflows. I don't know how to do that. What's the lingo in your...
debit and credit publications?
We have inflows and outflows are debits and credits of researchers and mobility, right?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
You guys imported me from Denmark. Yeah, I would show up in the data.
What's cool about this is like it wasn't until I kind of saw some of your papers and started realizing that they were answering questions that I had or questions that I wish I had thought to ask. So for example, when one of your papers, and please correct me because again it's me quoting you to you, talked about research productivity from grants and grants awarded, and that one of your results were that the people that get the most money aren't actually the most productive. Do you want to expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, well, that's a very good example, Sam, and I think it's very relevant to academics and to everyone. Decreasing returns, decreasing marginal returns of research funding, I think was the title of the paper. Basically, scientists get grants or do research, and there's this Mathieu effect. There's many reasons why in the reward system of science, the more you got, the more you will receive. So if you already got a grant, they'll be more happy to give you more grants. Yeah. And then you get more grants. And then you get so much grants that you might not know what to do with that money, and you start like being less efficient with it. If I give you one, you're going to squeeze that limit because that's all you got. But if I give you 5 million, it's by like something irrelevant. Whatever. They're always accountable. But anyway, the point is, this mechanism leads to concentrations of resources in the hands of a minority of researchers. And that's something that we observe in the paper. Like most money goes, the majority of the money goes to the minority of the researchers who would be eligible to apply for it. So that's a highly concentrated distribution of resources, which is something that we might want to question. like right away? Like, why is money not more equally distributed? Ah, because the best researchers, and then it's this narrative of like, we give it to the best because they can exploit it better. And then our paper kind of calls that into question, or actually puts a limitation to that and says, there's a point where like this system stops to be efficient. And is that every time you give more, there's, you're actually squeezing a little less of your best researcher, and best being like whole old white man who's been doing this since the 70s and is not retiring yet, because why would he with his 500 every year? I'm exaggerating a little bit here. Of course, when you're a junior researcher, you cannot be defined as the best from a bibliometrics perspective, which is like how much papers that you published in the past. I mean, if you don't have funding before, it's hard to get funding. If you're a junior researcher, guess what? You never got funding before. So how do you even start? And so there's an age or, you know, bias in this, and well, okay, what if? I'm digressing a little bit here, but
but it's great because you were able to say like, there's a problem, and it's like, well, people want to say, well, we're giving all the money to the people that are the best and they're going to do the most with it. And your research says, well, actually there's a cap to it. So now we can empirically say there's actually a reason why instead of giving the most to a little bit, like 80-20, it should actually be more like, you know, it should be distributed in order to do the greatest impact. And yeah, you might be giving it to some people that don't have an impact, but overall the impact will be greater because you have spread it out and they're able to do more with what they have.
And it's not that we have to distribute this equally. I don't think the system, like I believe in the like meritocratic, let's say, like the more you did, the more you, it's a proof that you might be able to, like, so there's some efficiency in the system and it makes sense, but there's a point where it breaks. And it kind of counterintuitive that governments, like we've seen in Canada in the recent years, and I don't know where this program started, but there's this thing like where we create this very, very large grant to attract like international, like we have this, we're it's hard, I don't exactly have the numbers. So I don't want to say something that's wrong, but like there's this tendency of like having bigger pies. We're going in the opposite direction, essentially. We have this giant grant where people come in like heroes, and we give them all the money. And I think my opinion and my belief, based on not just based on this research, but also like being an academic myself, knowing how it's hard to get funding, and you know that we're all capable of publishing good research, that you would be better off taking that $100 million and giving it to, you know, 1,000 scientists rather than one over a decade.
And now we have the data to prove it. Hey, I'm just going to back up and then I'm going to go forward because I want to talk about your TEDx paper. But the backing up part talks about, like when I was an undergrad, I didn't actually know that some of my profs or most of my profs did research. So we've talked about in a previous podcast that profs typically do teaching, research, and service. And some profs are... So for myself, I'm an instructor and my track is to be involved in the CPA profession. And that can be in research aspects or that can be in, you know, teaching or leading training sessions. Whereas your role as an assistant professor and soon to be next July 1st, associate professor.
Don't jinx it. Don't jinx it.
Oh, okay. Knock, knock, knock on all the letters. But almost, okay. But is, you know, approximately, you know, 40% teaching, 40% research and service. So what we're focusing on now is the research elements. And so when, as somebody who was research curious a number of years ago, especially since I entered into academia and realizing, oh, cool, there's a great world out here. The famous researchers that I was the first aware of were people like Adam Grant and Cal Newport and people that showed up on, you know, the TEDx stage. It really gave a story to their research and to the, you know, the research of others. However, I was very, very surprised to know that perhaps, you know, the success on the TEDx wasn't necessarily, you know, related one for one with their success as, you know, quote, their success as academics. So do you want to tell us a little bit about your TEDx study?
Oh, that's a good one, Sam. I haven't looked at this paper in so long.
I should preface this. I'm so sorry. But Philippe does and 20s in hundreds of projects. So like he's involved in so much. When I say it's 40%. So yeah, I am going to put you on the spot a little bit, but if you want to say pass, we can do that too.
No, I think I can talk generally about, you know, the correlation between, or the different ways in which science or scientists, you know, produce, disseminate knowledge. And you know, there is this one view that is the bibliometric view that, like, you know, historically we add citations to measure your, like, number of publications. Oh, that's a very productive researcher. But is his research excellent? Is he really good at, does he publish good papers? Oh, we have citations. So if another paper cites this work, it means that it was useful. So that paper is giving credit to that paper. And so if that paper gets cited a lot, then this is a good researcher. He published a lot of paper and gets a lot of citations. Super elite, right? And then there's elite institutions like Harvard, whatever. Why is that? Why is it historical? And there's lots of reason why, you know, Harvard and other elite universities are what they are. And then people, probably regardless of what they publish, but, you know, there's correlation. You publish a lot, you go to Harvard, but not, it's not a perfect correlation. And then they can sort of like have this prestige status or whatever. I don't know why I'm talking about prestige now, but just to say, I'm talking about limits of the indicators. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and you might be you might be doing excellent work that is recognized as excellent and in a lesser known institution and still be awesome. So, you know, these indicators, I just want to put out there.
Absolutely.
They are not perfect, and they tend to correlate a little bit. And then that's where we get all this nonsense where, citations correlate with like qualitative assessment of someone's like eliteness. So then they are good measures, but they're kind of very tricky. But I guess, you know, you go on a TED Talk. TED Talk is a different forum. There's different audiences. There's probably a correlation between, you know, having visibility and then getting invited on a TED Talk, but that has nothing to do with like how much science you're publishing, although it might hurt. So I don't know where I'm going with this time. We might want to cut this at the
nothing is cut in post-production.
No, oh geez, okay. But yeah, I would say, but I gave a talk earlier today about the diversity of like forms of like engagement and impact and channels through which science gets disseminated. And we know from that study that, yeah, it's concentrated, but some papers will get a lot of tweets. They'll be on Twitter all over the place, very popular, leading or part of supporting some global discussions on social media. Some will make the news, other will inform policies, and other will be highly cited, but those things are not necessarily the same. So you might be on a TED Talk because you know some people, whatever gets you there. Maybe you're just working on a topic that is hot right now, and then you get invited, and it gives you visibility, and it might have an effect on your career, but it might not. So there's questions there, but it's just about, you know, I think for me, the diverse way in which you can be scientist. You can be on Twitter, you cannot be on Twitter, but that, so there's this non-monolithic, let's say, understanding of what it is to produce and disseminate research, which is fundamentally our sort of social role as researchers.
Absolutely. And the thread that kind of ties all that together is impact, right?
Oh, I thought you were going to say chaos, which is
no thread fear. At all. Oh, beer. Yeah. It's friendship. It's drinking beer and mourning the friendship that once was. No, but it's impact. It's like, how do we measure impact? What is impact? And, you know, when you talk about the H index, you know, that kind of the mixing of two measures, how many papers did you publish? How many were they cited? And then looking at other measures of impact. So like, you know, myself before, you know, starting my doctorate being like, oh, I've seen that researcher on TEDx, you know, oh, I've seen this person here. And other people maybe that are on social media, I've seen this on Twitter. And so to different people, depending on what lens they're looking at, what metrics are important to them, what is impacting them and their interest. And so I thought, you know, in reading the abstract, however, giving a TED presentation appeared to have no impact on the number of citations subsequently received by an academic suggesting that although TED popularized his research, it may not promote the work of scientists within the academic community. So it's really important to know where the impact is having. And, you know, knowledge mobilization is huge, and that's awesome. However, perhaps if your goal as a researcher is to maximize your citation score, TEDx wouldn't be your venue, but your impact on society might be awesome.
It might, but it's a dangerous thing. Like, because you could, the downside of that is that you can twist the thing and say, well, that person is a superstar, goes on TED Talk, therefore whatever he says is scientifically valid. But, you know, there's a risk there too. You know, you can be a superstar on Twitter because you tweet a lot and you have a lot of followers, and then we might sort of value this or assign some sort of like expertise, like, oh, this person is knows it all, right? Because you can see it. So that, and then there's the struggle, because in science, if some people are known within their community as the authority, and everybody has some form of authority, but you know, there's a social structure and it's a bit complex, but you know, there are people that we respect as scholars in the field of bibliometrics. We have, you know, there's a core set of people that like there are the founders of the field, and then, you know, are very influential, and then, you know, we trust their work, and then whatever. And then that might not be the same person that, like, from on social media, maybe they're not there, and then some other person is the guru of bibliometrics. And that's fine. But, like, there should be no gurus, I think, or like that. Anyway, sorry.
No, this is
I don't like gurus.
No, it's great. My lens definitely didn't, that it could possibly, the negative would be to popularize somebody and see them as an authority when perhaps they aren't, you know, necessarily rooted in science or the rigor of science. So, hoping that places like TED would vet, but, you know, you get a big enough venue, you get enough people, you get enough things, then it definitely brings in some interesting questions.
I would just to wrap this up, that part, the point is, no single measure will give you the whole picture. So if you look up Twitter to find your expert, but don't consider anything else, well, who knows what you're getting, what you're finding. So combine sources, understand that nothing is a monolith, and that the different channels will give you different windows on the reality that you're trying to capture. But that's what I would say to wrap this thing up.
Absolutely, kind of like the balance sheet and the income statement and the cash flow statement and different, provide the economic reality of the business or the organization.
Okay.
I'll move on. All right, what's your favorite part of your gig as a prof? Like, it can be teaching, research service, it can be one of those, or it can just be like, just in general, like what lights you up?
Oh, that's I thought it would be like when you started asking the questions, oh, that's an easy one. And then I was like, it's kind of an easy one. Like, it's everything. Like, I like every part of it. I think it's kind of a boring answer, because some people say, what I love is the teaching and the students. And I love teaching and the students. I have such a blast in class and like shaping those minds. And then and I work with a lot of students and research and extracurricular projects. And I just love that part, to be part of this community, and then just, you know, be in a space or create a space where you can all learn and grow and do things and try to, I don't know, just, do things that we might contribute to our, you know, to our growth as in future professionals or, you know, societal, but like, you know, I don't know.
No, you do.
But we do fun stuff, but it's about fun. It's everything is fun. We have fun with everything we do, and we just learn every day, because that's kind of the nature. Like, we're learning, we're teaching, but it's all conflated, and we meet a lot of very interesting people, and we kind of sort of work together towards shared goals, and that's just like really empowering. And that's the research part, but it's also the service part, right? So I serve on committees, and I meet other colleagues here. So there's students, there's colleagues. It's all, you know, it's all people, relationships, and like shared goals, and like debates that can be sometimes frustrating, but also sometimes like enriching. And then, you know, and then again, a learning process and an understanding of Dalhousie and its whatever is happening, and everything that we do is as a this learning component, this social component. And I really like that. And the research part is kind of the same, right? We have a lab and then we have ideas. Sam, you're part of that, and a bunch of students, and we bring international collaborators, and it's constant flow of like thoughts and ideas, and we write papers, we present papers, we go to conferences. And it's so much fun. All of it is fun. And I don't have a single thing in there that I prefer. Yeah, but I would not want to do like more than 20% service, which is, you know, what's in our collective agreement. So I like all of it.
Yeah. Meetings is just a week is good enough for me. I agree.
I like the balance, and I don't want to change that. But yeah.
That's interesting, because some of the highlights from the last year that I can think of were Spain. So you went to Granada. So many members from your lab, your international collaborators, a few of your research assistants, like people from the lab, went to Granada and were able to present and be really enriched in that academic community.
Do you want me to talk about this for 2 seconds? I don't know.
Yes.
You asked me what I like the best. I mean, you know, you meet someone, they have some ideas, they're interested in your field, they don't know anything about it. You show them your bibliometric databases and they get interested, and then they start like brainstorming questions, like, what about this? And it's like, oh, that's a good question. And then they dive in, they get interested. They go to Granada, meet the international community of bibliometrics. That's like the main conference in the field. So, and there were three of us, four with me, going there. And I met a lot of friends in STI. And to see them, like, you know, and presenting in front of like people that I've known for decades, and that are like the, I don't know, it's something very like, I don't know, it's like a dad or, you know, a parent watching their kids play ball and like hit a home run. And then it's kind of great. I love that part, like supporting and then seeing like the success of the students. And Canada is a part of it. I mean, it's also like a nice, you know.
Wow. Yeah.
It's a vacation in Spain, you know, to disseminate research, you meet colleagues. That's part of this science or the research part. That sometimes, can I just ramble for a minute?
I would love that, yeah.
That's not a ramble, but I just say, sometimes we think about research as like writing papers.
Yeah.
And that's true, because that's, you know, we contribute to the stock of knowledge by publishing our findings. If you don't write papers or disseminate in any kind of way, you're not really a researcher, you're just doing stuff. And being a researcher is really, it's being part of a community.
Yeah.
And producing knowledge. And then there's this tension between, you know, whether you should produce knowledge for your community or for the public, and then it's kind of, or the knowledge translation. So you can, you're always playing both at the same time. But the point is, there is a community, and, you know, peer review, that those are your peers, and then you need to disseminate. And going to conferences, I don't know that everybody like does it that much, but for me, it's crucial, because once you understand the like science as a community and your field as a community of people, those bonds, yes, you can form them through like Zoom. But as we know from the past couple of years, that's not the same. Like, you know, when you're all gathered together in Spain for a couple of days and we talk about each other's research, and it's so engaging, you get feedback and different perspectives from people around the world, and then you go to celebrate all our nice work at the pub afterwards, or walk through like some city that you've never gone to were it not for the conference. You forge these bonds with members of your community. They can then come visit you, and you start collaborative projects, you apply for grants together. And or they get to know you and your work. So you get like, you know, citations, even though that's not the ultimate measure of success, but you become a part of this community. And that's so important. And when I see people say, oh, I'm just going to write a paper, or where are you going to publish? I don't know. Or if you don't have that community, for me, it's like, wow, you're missing out on the whole concept of being a member of what we call scientific community. That's a thing. It's not this like repository of papers where you just like send stuff to, and you know, you exist as a human in a group.
And when you see people. Citations and you see who cites who and who writes perfect and who writes with who, you're actually looking at, you know, who's who's co-authoring things together? Have they co-authored one item, or have they been co-authoring for several different items? Does somebody tend to want to publish by themselves, or does somebody tend to publish in groups? Did somebody publish, with their supervisor, predominantly, and then never publish again? There's a lot of behaviors in there. And so when we talk about networks and we talk about communities and we talk about lifting people up, forging a path so that we can therefore, have the resources to help other people forge their own paths, this can be represented in the research that you do. And so what you do is community build and community broaden. And I think discussing the research dissemination part and that process, that is something that wasn't evident to me before, but I'm so grateful that I've been able to be a part of your community and part kind of introduce myself to that research element at Dal, because it isn't intuitive if you didn't go, master's PhD with a supervisor in the same location. It's not always intuitive. So I love this. And in fact, I love that you don't just talk the talk, but you walk the walk with all the elements, including how your office is structured. So do you want to kind of share a bit about how your office was structured when you arrived here at Dal and what it looks like now?
Yeah. It doesn't look like it, but I hate talking. I prefer walking. My office was an office with a huge desk in the two section and me in the middle and a big screen, and then people walk in. And then first thing I did is I bought this chair. I cannot really, I'll show you the chair. I bought this fantastic yellow chair. Oh my God. No, I cannot. I'm sorry. The wire is
it's gorgeous. It's a gorgeous
yellow chair. I'll grab it. Like this chair right here. I got this chair.
It's not light. It's amazing.
It's yellow. Yeah. and so my office would be a little bit more like comfortable and welcoming to people. And I get rid of the old furniture that was like, those big filers, and get rid of that. But it was still like clogged with this big desk. And then, and honestly, I would have kept my office, but what I really wanted was a collective space, because I grew up as a researcher in a lab, and, we had eight people in a big square room with our desks and a couch in the middle and a big whiteboard. And every day we came and worked together on project. And I thought that environment was so fruitful for me. And that's what I want for my people. I think it has, I like to create these collaborative and collective spaces. And so I got rid of my desk and I just walked the halls and tried to see if there was a table that didn't seem to be used. And then I repopulated this desk with three desks. My chair is still here.
Love it.
And then I shouldn't say that in your podcast, but then I got this big TV over there. So like, instead of I have a whiteboard over here, but we also have this TV. When we make these networks of like science papers or whatever, we can put them on the screen and work together. So there's four people actually I could work in here. Right now it's more set up for three.
Yeah.
But the idea is, it became a lab. That's my lab. I would have liked to have a room given to me that would have been the lab. We actually have several rooms that we occupy, but anyway, I made
that start somewhere. And the fact that you said, hey, this is important. And then you went out and had action, which is something I really respect, because at the end of the day, if you just keep yelling into the void, but you're not willing to put your ass where it matters, then what are you really doing? So
don't ask for permission. And don't even ask for forgiveness. Just do it.
Just do it and be like, look, this is awesome. And no, it's great. It definitely helps inspire me to do something in my own space that was in line with my values. I wanted something a little bit more aesthetically pleasing and something, a place where my TAs could come and feel comfortable. So I stocked it up with snacks. I painted a wall pink and I bought some furniture, and I love my space. It is my happy space.
I was able to say you find pink walls as pleasing and welcoming. And I'm scared of walking into your office. I'm just kidding. I love pink. I used to have a sport teams, and our shirts were pink. I love pink.
What was your team? Because you played a lot of intramural sports. What was your team called again?
The Raging Popcorns. And we had a logo, three popcorns. And there was one thinking about his mom, scared. Another one was completely berserk, I'm going to destroy you. And a strategic one with the cup in his mind. And so it was a team of Raging Popcorns. That was really great.
What is that in French? Like, what's, how do you say that?
Les popcorn enragés au bois. Yeah, because we use the word popcorn because mais soufflé is kind of boring. So, les popcorn enragés. Yeah.
Okay, raging popcorns.
Sorry, that's
no, this off, is good. The point. No, it's actually the point because it wasn't just you, but other profs here at Dal have, you know, said that intramural sports was a large part of their PhD, and it really just speaks to the community building. And I think that, you know, we were in a faculty meeting today where, you know, we have faculty stuff and there's pancake initiatives and there's Christmas parties and there's all these things to kind of, you know, piecemeal build community. But at the end of the day, you know, sometimes you just have to have a Teams call with somebody that your colleague is like, hey, go talk to Philippe. And I was like, cool. All right. And then, you know, when Philippe comes here, go for a beer and like, see if you can get along with people and just go and make your own opportunities and reach out for that coffee or reach out for those different things and build your community, because you can't always rely on other people to do it. So I love that you've done that at Dal. And, you know, I've also in my accounting role tried to do that. So it's just so important.
I agree.
So, okay, we know about the positive things about your field and you know, Dal, and like that you love all of your elements, but are there any problems with your field? Because accounting is perfect. Accounting is perfect and can stay that way forever. Just kidding. I will have a separate rant. But any problems within your field?
Oh my gosh, Sam. What a loaded question. There's so many problems. Well, we already touched on the concentration of funding and citation, all that stuff. And there's, of course, if you use citations as indeed like evaluation of research causes inequalities and access to opportunities, funding, positions in academia. So there's like all these biases that like my field, it's not really a problem of my field, but sometimes my field as being the producer of those indicators that we use to measure, I kind of complicit and I don't like to think that we are complicit, but like administrators take our indicators and apply them in ways that like create inequalities. And that's something that we actually criticize or critical about, but this is an outcome of a misuse of bibliometrics. That one thing, and our field, like any other field, all kinds of issues with the you know, all the equality EDI issues. They are everywhere, including in any fields of science, including ours. But that's probably not what you want me to talk about.
No, I'm.
and it's also not a problem in my like the field of bibliometrics, but one problem that in science that maybe is where you're trying to go, that has driven some of my research is the publishing industry. Is that what you want me to talk about?
You can, if it's a problem. I mean, if there's no problem.
Of course it's a problem. Don't get me started. I mean, you did get me started. So, okay, researchers. I mean, researchers are paid by government money, student fees, and a combination of things, but essentially it's publicly let's call it, most of our studies are paid by public funds or student tuitions. And so there's this social contract where we produce knowledge that we input into the world and that people can use to advance and to innovate. And so this like, again, is a social role of science. And then we write these documents essentially for free because I'm not paid to write a paper, right? I'm paid to be here and teach. Actually, I'm not paid to do research, right? I get grants with which I can hire students and then help them support them as they become researchers or just engage with research. But I don't get paid for doing research. I'm given time as part of my role to do research. And then so essentially I do research for free.
Yeah.
It's just part of my,
part of your job.
Yes. And some like to think of the teaching part as the part that like, you know, because they're a student and because we are paid partly by student tuition, and that would be the part where I generate money and then that pays my salary and then I can do research. Anyway, so I do research for free and then I publish it. I submit it to a journal. These journals, by the way, they have editorial boards of people like me. I sit on the editorial board of the QSS journal, which is the main journal of my field. And there's an editor in chief that is usually not paid, but in some corporation like, sometimes they're paid a little bit, depends on the journal, and that's something I criticize, but anyway. They're usually a person like me also, and then basically the paper gets sent to reviewers, so that's peer review, and then so two people, sometimes three, will look at my paper. Free, they will use their research time. So I have a bit of research time. So I use some of my research time. I don't just write papers all the time. I do presentation. I do other things that I write for. It's so broad, the kinds of things that we do that are part of this like research bubble. But one of it is peer reviewing. So I get the editor of the journal, say, hey, Phil, can you review this? And then they review it. I spend half a day, constructive comments, say yes. And I judge the paper based on its originality or whatever criteria we have. But then typically, is it making a contribution? Is it sound? Blah, blah, blah. Submit my review, it gets back, and eventually the paper gets published. And all of this work so far has been done voluntarily-ish by academics like me, who are paid by public funding to conduct research and publish it and send it into the world.
So basically, up until this point, this is all public. No, this is all paid for. Like all the labor is by academics and all the labor is paid for the public and really the students who are the public. So everything is funded by the public and the work is done by the researchers. I don't see a problem. This sounds lovely.
Exactly. It's lovely. And then you have a PDF that contains the text. And everything is done, right? And then sometimes even it gets published on some repository. And then comes this layer of like publishing, which is just making what is publishing? It's like taking something and putting it on the internet, basically. And it has something, not even a stamp of it, it's published, it made public. And everybody can make stuff public. You can tweet and you just made your thought public on a tweet. A tweet is a public statement. It's a document, if you will. Just like a paper that we just co-constructed through the peer review process for free. But fortunately, unfortunately, there was a time where scientists couldn't really, when we didn't have the internet. And so came this super prolific, or not prolific, but I don't know if I want to go so far in history, but like, it doesn't really matter. But anyway, they were created, sometimes we needed publishers. So publishers are corporations that say, hey, I'm going to take your paper. And then they provide platforms or some administrative support. So they're not completely useless. And I already give you the punch. They are useless. but you see that we just produced the paper. It's written and everything. And it just needs to go in some platform. And then journals come in and they have like, not journals, but journals operate. Journals are run by us. The journal is a mostly scientist run thing. But journals are owned by publishers most of the time. And the publishers actually, like the market of publishing is a multi-billion dollar industry. And and how does it work? That basically me at Dal, we publish a lot of papers, and you at University of X and Y, you publish a lot of paper. And then we all have libraries that give us access to our own paper, basically. Yeah. And that access is basically purchased through those big corporations at amazingly, frustratingly high costs. Like Dal spends multiple millions of dollars every year buying its own basically research output and the output of others. But yes, it's the output of others, but we constructed it. I reviewed this paper, and most of it's already online anyway, but let's forget about that.
But you're, so basically, I'm an accountant and you're losing me, because right now, I understand that. So how much do the publishers of the journals, how much did they pay the researchers to write and submit?
Of course, zero.
Zero? Okay.
Sam, were you not listening?
No. But then they charge the universities to have access to the publications that the researchers made?
Yes. And they call this the big deal, because we used to, never mind. But
please, no. What's the big deal?
There used to be a time, and it's always been a scam, right? What's his name? The father of the guy who funded, what's his name? Maxwell, Robert Maxwell. You might know of Robert Maxwell, a crook. He got thrown off a boat at some point, in a sketchy debt, because he was mingling in the wrong circles. Anyway, Ghislaine Maxwell, daughter,
yeah.
Bunch of crooks. He's the founder of this thing, essentially. He's the guy I was going to talk about in the 50s who created Elsevier, what came to be Elsevier, which is now the biggest publisher. Basically, they just bribed people. They went to conferences. I'm going to tell you a story. And I'll tell you the story. I'll get to the cereal crisis and to the whole like big deal thing. But I'm going to try to do it fast because, you know, I've been talking about it. They recognize that scientists need to publish as part of their role. So, and that science is so that like every little piece of paper, like, you know, the microscopic advance is going to get published. So they publish anything, well, not anything, but like, you know, there's papers are getting published, right? And we need to publish, and we need to have access to other people's work in order to like to read and then do something that actually contributes to the current state of knowledge in our field. So that requires access to the current state of knowledge, which is the published work. And they said, wow, and then these guys, they publish, and then they absolutely need other people's work. And they're like, you know, yeah, so they, and if we create a journal, they will need that journal and they will run the journal. And then, so what they did is they went on boats and they took, I mean, it's an anecdote in an article that I don't have in front of me, so I can't. The Guardian, the title is a staggeringly profitable industry of scientific publishing. And so if you Google some of those words, you will probably find the article I'm talking about, and it will tell you a better story. So I recommend this.
I'll put it in the show notes.
Yeah. And, basically, yeah, you read the article, but they kind of realized that they could create an unlimited amount of journals, and that no matter what they did, they were going to find some people to publish in it. So that's why they went to Congress. Hey, you want to be the editor of a journal? Hey, you want to be the editor? Yeah, I know it's going to help your career, and it's going to, and then people are going to publish in the journal, and then we're going to sell the journal to the, and then we're going to make money. So that's their business model, right? They created new journals, lots of new journals, because they could, and because, well, I need this journal, this journal, my field, and everybody, like, we just bought it all. And they made a lot of money. But then they really started making a lot of money. Problem, at this time, every time a library buys a journal, then you need to mail it to them. Like, the journals used to be, like, now we have the internet, but, like, back in the days, you get the volume, and then you read the papers, and you store it on the shelf, and libraries have large collections of periodicals, which is all the issues of a journal since whatever. And then we had a space problem, and we started to have a money problem, because those publishers create new journals, increase their prices. You need to have access to paper, so they have some sort of monopoly. Due to the originality requirement of a piece of research, so if there's two journals and you do something, you write a paper, there's an assumption that it was original in some way, and so you cannot have the same paper published elsewhere. So every paper is a small monopoly of a bit of knowledge. And so as academics, we're kind of obsessed with having access to it all. And that's another part of the problem. But basically, we buy it all no matter how much you make and how much you sell them. And so it's a perfect business. Like, is it demand elasticity or price? No matter how you raise the price, it doesn't affect demand, because we need it. Exactly. Yeah. And so that was fantastic. But then we ran out of money and space, and came about the digital era. So what happened in the digital era is that, well, I don't need to mail you anything, and I don't need to produce a volume. So I can have one PDF, lock it behind a website, and just sell access to the same PDF. So basically, I reduced my costs drastically as a publisher. And guess what? They did not reduce the cost or the price. Of course, they continue to increase it, because whatever, right? And one of the methods that they used to do that, of course, is they created even more journals and bought it, because it's even easier than, I create a journal. What is this? It's just a new page on my website. It's called the Journal of X. It has an editorial board, people who serve for free. They'll publish some papers. And I'll say, oh, look, my collection. And so that's the big deals. The big deals are, we'll solve all the problems. I'll give you access to everything. And you'll sign this contract, and you just have access to my entire collection. It's amazing. It's a big deal. And then the contract is, well, you just have a 5% increase in your fees per year or something like that, right? And so we kept pouring more and more and more and more money into a collection of journals. And then they create journals and say, oh, I have like 600 journals in my collection. It's 2 million to have access to all of that, or 6 million. Or you're a bigger university, it's more expensive, because, of course, the same PDF is worth more money if you're a bigger. So there's this, like, it became a kind of a subscription based model, and then they suddenly reduce their cost, increase their their revenues and kept growing. And they created journals that nobody uses. And we did a study on this, like those packages. I have 600 journals. I give them all to you for this nice little sum of $2 million, which is not that much, but actually it is. But what they don't tell you is that when you look at what the scientists actually use, it's like 20 of the 600 journals. I'm exaggerating a little bit. No, yeah. So it's just a tactic. And then I am rambling a lot here, but like this thing.
No, this is perfect because, no, because I'm like, some people listening to this are accountants. And when I first heard this, I was shocked. And I remember you came in and so you shocked me so much that I almost missed Pilates. Like I was listening to you give a talk, I'll link it down below, because you definitely talk about this, in somewhat more depth, but also somewhat more broadly. This has been great. And I was just shocked that, you know, you have a company, a corporation that effectively uses a lot of academic labor funded by public, and then continues to increase their prices. And where I really got stuck is, why don't academics just say, screw you, publisher. We're going to take our, you know, our knowledge and we're going to put it elsewhere. So that is something that definitely I was so confused about. And fortunately, your talk kind of it helped me kind of work through it. And then I had to go through another loop as to why we're still doing it. So is that fair to ask you? Why are we still doing this if we know that it's not good?
I'm going to try to give a shorter answer, but like, you know, the exchange is hard, right? And people have, not everybody realizes that just how much it costs, because you're not the consumer, right? I don't buy Elsevier journals. Dalhousie Library does it. And libraries are so good at being transparent that you don't even know they exist. And then you access a paper, you paid for it, and you thought it was free because you could just access this for free on your computer. So a lot of researchers are not aware of these things, although that's changing a little bit, you know, more and more discussions, but it remains surprising just how many people are not aware. And those who are aware, you know, it's like, it's the way of the world, as Mike said in an earlier meeting today. They don't see that they can make a difference. Mm. And the truth is that they can, but like, because journals, we can't change science and all of publishing. But there's a few examples that are uplifting, and one of them is QSS, a journal of which I am an editorial board member, who was an Elsevier journal. It's called the Journal of Informatics, and the Journal of Informatics still exists because Elsevier owns it. But the board, so all the members of my community that were like, you know, running this journal for free for Elsevier, decided we're fed up with this, and then they quit. I was not on the board at the time, so they quit. And created this new journal that is an open access journal that publishes papers for free. There's an APC charge, so there's another business model, but it's like not, you know, it's published with MIT Press, which is a university press. So it's not perfect, but it's way better than Elsevier. And there's other models that actually sort of use library publishing is creating a journal is not that hard, first of all, and there are platforms that exist that are free to help you run a journal. And in Canada, we have ELZ and Coalition Publica. And it's organizations that actually are nonprofit publishers. So all the Canadian journals published through ELZ are typically extremely low APCs, or actually you publish in them for free and they're openly available for free. So they fix the problem. And it's a consortium of libraries and universities and the federal funding agencies that fund the system. So there's some money that goes into it. We need to pay people to sort of like, you know, maintain the platforms. So there is a cost, right? It's not that there is no cost. It's just that, like, you know, Elsevier will charge you $5,000 for one article, which is a ridiculous cost, right? And the actual cost, as you would probably see through ELZ, is they probably have like, I don't know, a few hundred maybe as the overhead forces per paper. But if they scaled up, maybe it would go down. And so, you know, it's absolutely not 5,000.
Never will be. No. And it kind of goes back to like the question, you know, are businesses inherently evil? And that's probably a topic for another podcast. But, you know, what is the purpose of the organization? And if the purpose of the organization is a business, the business's job is to maximize shareholder value. Whereas, you know, what is the value for shareholders in publishing? And can there be another way? So perhaps it's the not you know, the not-for-profit model, perhaps within that it's, you know, cost recovery, or really, you know, it's really like, why should we be making money from this? And really, who is, who are these corporations and who are these shareholders making the money off of the backs of? And so I think that that is the question that your talk, your subsequent talks with my students, that really helped me, you know, question, why are we doing this? And I love that there is positivity, that there is so much good in people, you know, walking their talk and working towards that. And it's just too bad that there's the majority of the momentum, as you said, that change is hard. And I don't want to skim over this lightly, but it's my understanding that a lot of times it's not just the people don't know. It's not just that, you know, change is difficult, that absolutely, yes. But it's my understanding there's something else in there too. And that's, you know, the ranking system and the tenure and promotion elements. So, you know, do you want me to summarize and you can correct, or do you want to give it a go?
Well, it's up to you. I can give it a go. I can try to be more brief. I keep saying I'm going to be more brief.
No. I love that you're robust. I just hesitate to, to speak about something that, you know, when I have, you're not debiting and crediting, so I'm not going to bibliorize.
Okay, I'll do it. Basically, tenure and promotion, I don't know. There's this reward system that wants me to publish and be cited, and then, I don't know. Actually, I don't really know.
So,
I don't know how I would approach it. Go for it, Sam.
You know, researchers, you're evaluated on your teaching research service, as well as, you know, there's a couple of other elements in there depending on your collective agreement. But the research is essentially, you are evaluated by your peers in Canada and the United States, possibly other countries. You are hired as a probationary tenure track professor. Then after 3 years, you have to reapply for your job. And then after 6 years, you get to, you know, hopefully be promoted, have tenure, and have that academic freedom for life. So within that evaluation, reevaluation process, they're ranking your teaching and service, but they're mostly, for most schools, really focusing on your research. And the way that they judge your research is based off of the quality and sometimes quantity. Yes. Mm-hmm. And so quality, no, absolutely, quality of your research. And so mm-hmm. What is a metric for quality? Well, there's these lists that exist, and the lists, you know, one of them might be the Financial Times 50, the top 50 journals by the Financial Times. One might be the Australian Business Dean's Council list, which has, you know, the top, you know, journals ranked, you know, A star, A, B, C, according to those lists. So different schools, business schools will have different lists that they use. They may have an internally generated list, which is where Dalhousie, our faculty, is going. But right now, our business school uses the ABDC list and Financial Times as a proxy. So within that, when you state what the rules of the game are, then the players, the professors that, you know, want to do good, want to teach students, want to disseminate their knowledge, want to share and grow and keep their jobs, publish according to the journals that are on these lists. And those journals that are on those lists don't tend to be the nonprofit open access. They tend to be the ones that, you know, have always been there, have had those esteem. So it really is this perverse system that we hold ourselves to for the benefit of a corporation.
Yeah, I think you said it pretty well. I would add the impact factor as a measure. So it's not this, sometimes it's not a list, it's like these mega things. But I will also add that the list that we are going to have at Dalhousie is going to be created by us. And that's yes. where you can blame the system. Yes. But like, we might decide at Dalhousie that like we value journals that are not published by a commercial publisher, and then Adele would start publishing in other places, and people will be rewarded for not publishing those venues. But I doubt that, like, it's never going to be that, because some of, you know, we want to have international visibility, and sadly, it happens to be that journal that is owned by Elsevier.
Self-fulfilling prophecy, but at least awareness, the questions, where am I publishing? Why am I publishing? I love how, I think it was either yourself or a talk by one of the people in the QSS lab that said, hey, a strategy might be, you know, publishing what you need to keep your job, you know, so reward is in keeping your job, and also publishing in open access. So there is an ability to kind of, you know, work within the system to make a positive impact, to acknowledge, and it doesn't have to be, you know, all or nothing. And that, you know, I believe it was you who said, change takes time and small changes still change.
I don't know if I probably didn't say that exactly like that, but yeah, I think the way to change the world, but that's something I like to say, is that we fail sometimes because, or we think that we fail because we're trying to change the system, but you don't change the system. You just do the things that you think we should all do. And if everybody does that and we kind of agree, then naturally the system is going to, the essence of humanity is the sum of our individual action. That's, you know, and that's the same principle here. If you want to have a system that works following your value, you just have to act according to your value, and then maybe encourage the people around you or build initiatives on a small scale that like are the embodiment of those values. And then if we all did that and we happen to share values, the system will change. It's just that we instead fall into the trap of like, well, but I have to because of tenure and promotion. And then sometimes it's a misguided fear, sometimes it's a real fear, sometimes it's a fear that we nurture inside our organizations, and that is an obstacle to change. Like if you're scared of not getting tenure promotion, you think that you have to do these things that you don't really believe in. Well, who's at fault? Is it the people inside your organization evaluating you? Is it yourself? Is it the system? Everything's got to change, but like it starts with us. And I think, you know, you can create a journal tomorrow. It might not be a big, like, you know, and what is success? If you try to compete with the Elseviers of the world right away, you will think that you're failing, but you're not failing. You create a new journal that is the embodiment of somebody's value, and some people publish in it. Might not be everyone, but in the long run, you made a difference. And if we all did that, I think the world would be a better place. I don't know what I went
no. No, it's great. Because we have two elements as we wrap this up. And one is I'm going to ask you for your definition of success. And the other is I'm going to tie our discussion back to beer. So I think that, no, I found the through line. Just yeah. So in our second to last element here, Philippe Mongeon, Dr. Mongeon, how would you define success?
I don't actually know how it's defined in the dictionary, but I imagine that it's something like, you know, reaching your goal. You have a goal, you reach it, you succeeded. It's as simple as that. Do you want me to develop?
No, is that how you, is that, so that's how you define success. You would determine, you set a goal and you meet it, that you've been successful on that element.
If you try to eat 7 hot dogs in the next 2 minutes and you eat 7 hot dogs in the next 2 minutes, you just succeeded. And
you
that is literally success. If you made it to 6 and then you puked, or you just like it was, you were too slow, then you failed. The question is that a goal? Is that a goal that you actually like? The question is, which goal do you set for yourself? And I think that's a more important question than what is success. Because what the success is reaching that goal. What's important is having goals that are in line. It's the goals. It's all in the goals that we set for ourselves.
The goals that we set for ourselves, and not the goals that the university or the, you know, or traditional academia or, you know, society tells us that we should set, which is why I love when I finally understood. Because I'm not going to lie, it pissed me off when we would share pitchers of beer, and I had to drink this beer that I was like, man, like, can't we get something good? And what I loved is not only have you opened my eyes to the world of academic publishing and really just knowledge and scholarship, also questioning my taste for beer. So am I getting this because it's what I want on that day, or is it because it's, you know, what I'm conditioned to want? And some days you know, it might not matter, but the signal of why you get the beer might matter. And so with that, I love that we've been able to have this chat. We'll see if we release it from the depths and dooms. We will, unless you hack my computer and you delete it. But thank you so much for coming on. And I look forward to like a part two, possibly with our missing other guest.
I feel like we could have gone for like much longer, but there's so much things we didn't talk about, Sam. But thank you for having me. This was a lot of fun. And we'll see.
Hey, well, one last thing. If people are like, hey, I want to reach out, like, are you cool to take some like emails from students?
Yeah, come and, 4032 at the Rowe building. Send my email, like whatever. Come sit in the yellow chair. I'll tell you all about open access and why it's crap. I'm just kidding.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
That's a controversial one. We should keep that for next time. But like, I think we missed an opportunity there because anyway.
It's always good to leave a little meat on the bone. Thank you.
See you.